Welcome to episode 265 of the Countdown Podcast. I hope you are feeling gangster. My name is Wayne.
And my name is Paul. Welcome to the podcast. We count down movies and sometimes television in order of awesomeness so you don't have to. And today, it's a bit of a different show. Something.
Tis a different show.
Out of the ordinary, because we live in a world which is out of the ordinary at the moment.
Right.
And shout out to all our listeners who are living a different life because of COVID-19. We hope you are safe. We hope you are well today. Based on a suggestion from listener, good friend, and fellow podcaster, Troy, from the Great Mates Podcast. Suggestion, mm-hmm. We are counting down the best films by year from the 90s.
Right. And you know what? I've been struggling for a name for this. I don't know if you've come up with anything, but one of our listeners did, and I kind of like it.
We had a few suggestions from different people. Go on. What was the one you liked from the suggestion?
The one I liked was from Tiffany Stoddart Sullivan, mm-hmm. who said, call it Decade Deathmatch. Or Decade Decathlon if you're feeling less competitive. But I kind of like Decade Deathmatch. I know it's not necessarily... It just sounds good. But that's me.
It does sound good, but I'm not sure it makes any sense when you read the title.
It doesn't make any sense. No, it just means it's like... It's just called something. It's something cool. So you can go, what is it? Decade Deathmatch. Best movie of every year. Boom. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. So are you going to call it Decade Deathmatch? Colin, best movie of every year of the 90s. Now, you're the one who always complains about the size of the writing on the caption on the card.
Yeah, because I do them. But so here's what I think, right? If you look at the title card, it's like episode 265, Decade Deathmatch, big writing. And then like down the bottom, you know, best films of the 90s. Or best film every year from the 90s. Something. I'll come up with a subheading that'll work.
Problem is we don't get the subheading. Oh, we can. Decade Deathmatch, best films of the 90s. I don't know. We'll work it out.
We're recording.
We haven't recorded. My brother did come back with a bunch of suggestions. Adam,
he
said, best year of films, 90s edition. And then my response was, best by year, the 90s, or the best films of the 90s by year.
Best by year is also a good call. I was thinking about this. If you want to go a little obtuse, it's like decadent, full colon, 90s edition.
That's too obtuse.
It's got the word decade. I know it's very obtuse.
Well, you know what we're doing, which is basically we're working our way through the 90s, and each year we're picking our favorite film. Not the best film, our favorite film.
Favorite
of the
film,
90s.
Exactly.
That's a different type of countdown if we were to be picking what we believe to be the objective best film, because I guarantee there's some films on my list which people are just going to go, fuck you,
If that is the case, right, then I'm really scared that we have the same list, because I'm sitting there going, you look at the list on the top hits of that year, and it's like, well, I think this, and I remember where Paul was when I said I think this, and we agreed. So maybe the only difference is like you've matured, you know. I certainly have not, you know. So it's like you're now different. No, I'm going to go with this one. So let's just see how this goes.
Obviously, when you talk about a list of films from a decade that is now 20 years removed.
Mm-hmm.
At least.
Yes, we're different
people
now.
There is a lot of nostalgia. There is a lot of heart.
Tons.
There's a lot less, I would suggest, head behind these choices. So,
and people, this...
Which is an odd thing to say to Wayne, because he's usually looking for a lot of head.
I wondered if you would do that, and then I found out. Okay, but here's the thing though, right? This was our heyday. Can we agree on that? The 90s was the heyday. All right?
My brother made that point as well. He said this was my heyday. And I'm like, yeah, maybe late 80s, early 90s was kind of the point where I loved every film.
It's straight up 90s, all right? Because we're out of high school in 92, all right?
Yep.
And then we get cars and shit that year. And then we start doing dumb shit that year. This is where we had our, like, somewhat, you know, the first titty was probably in this decade. The first titty feel was probably this decade, I reckon. I'm just guessing.
You know me. I sit here with weighty breasts and all logic flies out the window.
I should have known that this one would come up. Absolutely. That's just one aspect of it, people. You remember your first car, right? It was a big deal.
Wayne remembers his first pair.
I think it was only one. That's all I saw. Okay.
That's what we're doing
today.
All right.
Sorry.
And unusually long intro because we had to explain what we're doing. And the plan is that we will, with thanks to Troy, we will follow through all the decades that we have been sort of active in terms of watching cinema. So maybe 70s and onwards. I don't think going back, who knows, it could be fun to go back.
I don't know what the fuck happened in the 60s, man. wasn't chilling then. I wasn't born.
No, that is true. But anyway, that so this we'll see what the uptake is on this particular episode. But if it goes all right, then I think we'll return to the format because it could be a good fun one, and it gets us talk about a lot of our favorite films. Speaking of favorite films, I recorded with Julio from the Contrarians podcast during the week. Not sure when I'll be out just yet. Hopefully, very very shortly. Check out the Contrarians if you haven't already. And Julio and I counted down our favorite films from 100 to 91 because this is the beginning of our trip towards the top 10 films, our top 10 films of all time, which Wayne and I will do, which will be the final episode of the show. Now, I don't want to alarm anybody, and I do say this in the bonus recording. We're not planning to end the show at any point soon, but it is the first step towards that, so that over the next, could be 6 months, could be a year, it could be 5 years, you'll see my top 100 films as they are unveiled.
Just not on this show.
Well, yeah, it's the bonus episode, so it's not...
Oh, I see, yeah. I see.
You can tell Wayne's very up to speed and has not at all been...
Shut up, bitch.
...engaging in the gunja. Okay.
Hot damn!
Oh, damn.
All right, funny shit. Let's get into our first segment, supposedly of every show, because we run long on this first bit, the recount.
Who wants a recount? Who wants a recount?
The recount from the mailbox, Paulie. What did we get last week?
Well, first of all, want to settle something. On our Cats review a couple of weeks ago, I did ask whether or not Cats won any Razzies. Well, Brentley Oliver to the rescue. Brentley said, Cats won 6 Razzies, including worst film. Hooray.
Ah.
Rebel Wilson also won worst performance in supporting performance in any film. Hooray.
Well done.
So there were a worst script. Hooray. All the rest of that stuff. It deserved what it got.
So they held the Razzies?
They did. It was all digital and online, but they...
Oh, okay.
Matt from the Crossover podcast said, Rebel Wilson is what you get when you take Melissa McCarthy and siphon out the funny.
Ooh,
which I think
harsh.
Is a fair call.
Yeah, fair not call. Bad.
Harsh, but fair. Cinematic Adventure podcast said, the Countdown podcast, you thought the only furries would like Cats. Well, there is this wonderful headline and sent a picture with, even furries hate the Cats trailer.
I was thinking about that. You'd be spanking it if you were a furry, but apparently not.
Yes. Then here's some vindication for you, Wayne.
Word.
Super listener Chad, who's a great supporter of the show and includes us in lots of lists on Twitter and the like. So thank you very much for that, Chad. Wayne, you are so right about Sahara being a fun movie. I will also say the series of books are actually pretty good if you enjoy James Bond-style books. Dirk Pitt,
dude, I'm in.
Is a seagoing version of Bond. Fun as long as you don't really want reality bugging you.
That's exactly what I don't want. All right, I'm in. Thanks, fantastic. Oh, I never thought anyone would agree with me on this.
And neither did I, but therefore you have now felt...
Vindication!
Oh, you're an asshole.
Anth P also had your back. Another great podcast, boys, with some new recommendations just from last week, the top 10, last 10, especially from Wayne. We'll check out those docos. And, I won't forget your recommendation of Sahara.
Cool. What, as in, I hope you enjoy it if you haven't seen it already, bro.
Get the impression that Anth hadn't seen it. He said he agrees on The Hunt, which I recommended, but The Platform had a gun to his head and an emoji. So, apparently, did not enjoy The Platform at all. And then finally, for this week's recount, we got an email from a good friend of mine and listener to the show, Campbell. Here's what he had to say, going back to the top 10 TV villains. Wayne, great call on The Shield, cracking show. I tried to get Paul to watch it for years to no avail.
Nice one.
In the past, I've tried to protect you against the tyranny of Paul.
I can see the thing going. Go ahead.
But shocking call on Vic Mackey being a villain. He is.
Oh, so you like Vic?
Absolute hero of the show, definitely in towards an anti-hero, but the hero nonetheless. He says the best villain in that show was Forrest Whitaker playing Internal Affairs Cop, trying to bring Mackie down in seasons 5 or 6, I think.
Whoa, Cam hates authority. That's a... Oh, okay.
He pointed to the show's creator, Sean Ryan, who said this in a quote. If I said to you, I'm going to have a story about a corrupt cop who murdered another cop and stole a bunch of money, and that there's this pretty virtuous Internal Affairs detective who starts digging into the case and becomes hell-bent on bringing this man to justice, who would be the hero of the piece? But our audience viewed Vic as a hero. They wanted Vic to get away with it. They found every negative thing to say about Whitaker's character they could think of. When we wrote it, I was convinced, boy, we're really making it tough for the audience. They're not going to be sure who to root for. I was an idiot. They knew who to root for.
I agree. He's still the bad guy, though. Like,
I don't think you heard any of that.
No, he's he's the one you want to root for. He's the anti-hero, hero, whatever you want to call it, that is the one you're behind, but he's still the villain.
All right, like, so there you go, Campbell. Now you get a sample of what I deal with on a weekly basis with this podcast.
I understand completely what you're trying to say.
Doth not listen to reason.
No. Look, it's along the Bryan Cranston route, but I understand this confusion. But hey, that's why we talk. That's why these shows are on. It's for conversation.
All right. Thank you for that, Campbell, who also said, Paul, watch the bloody show. Yeah, I may well get to it eventually, Campbell. And that is it for this week's recount. Thanks to everyone who gets back to us with some feedback about the show. Let's get into it then. On the other side of this, I think very important promo, as we head only, if my maths are right, 5 weeks away from the live stream for a Cure event, which is what the Epic Film Guys host on a yearly basis to raise money for the fight against cancer. Here is their promo.
Can you imagine a world immune to all forms of cancer?
Ladies and gentlemen, the time has come for our fourth annual live stream for the cure.
And this year, we need your help more than ever.
Please join us May 27th through May 31st for 48 hours of live content from guests and podcasts around the world.
We'll be aiming for our most ambitious goal to date as we try to raise $10,000 for the Cancer Research Institute.
Please visit www.livestreamforthecure.com for more information on this year's event and how you can be a part of it. Together, we can make a difference.
I've just realized we don't know what the title of the episode is.
That's right. Okay, for placeholder speak, Decade Deathmatch is where we get... fuck it, I'm not even doing it.
Well, you know what we're doing. You know what we're doing, and that's what we're going to continue to do this time. We're going to start from 1990, work our way through to 1999. Boo-hoo sucks to you, to everyone who says that 1991 to 2000 should be the decade. It's too fucking confusing. So
I'm glad I guessed that right, by the way.
Hey, sorry?
I'm glad I guessed that. I could have gone either way.
Yeah. I do see the point, but we're just doing it this way because it makes more logical sense when you look at the title card. As much as it might say Decade Deathmatch or whatever the
God knows what I was going to say. Seriously.
All right, Wayne, lead us away. What's your best film, favorite film from 1990? And we better have the same fucking one. There's a few of these years where we better have the same fucking one, and here is one of them.
Look, I wanted to go Fleetwood Mac this and go my own way, but the and maybe make it like a little thing. But the truth is, this one for 1990, I'm sure everyone has this one because you just can't. Even me making jokes, I can't get away from it. It's Goodfellas. Is it Goodfellas?
Yeah, of course it's Goodfellas. This is the best film by a million miles from 1990.
Would you say it's? And we're not doing this, but would you say it's up there among the best of the 90s?
I'd say it's up there one of the best films of all time.
Definitely the 90s. Yeah, fair enough.
Perfectly, quite succinctly. How could you go past it?
Exactly. I think what's cool about it is that it shows you how people become gangsters, and it gives you Henry Hill's view as he experiences it. So he knows that he's Irish, he's never going to be made, he's this, he's that. But the best thing about the film, most definitely for me, is the goddamn nightclub scene. The one shot where he walks in and he's like, hey, I know all you people, I'm walking in the back, I don't go through the line.
One of the first examples of this kind of shot put together, which is just incredible. I love that scene, don't get me wrong. I just think the rest of the film is so perfect. Like, I watched this one of those very, very few films I watched when I was 15, 16 years old and thought it was amazing then. And yet now, 30 years later, I think it's amazing now. Like, I watched it last year most recently, and I've probably seen this film 5-6 times. I'm never bored. No. Never bored. It is just arresting from moment one when we're getting the cold opening, sort of 2/3.
The cold opening is almost the best thing. Almost.
And then
because you're just
going back through the rise and fall of Henry Hill and the fact it's based on a true story. I'm sure it's been exaggerated for
totally
dramatic purposes.
Apparently, Henry Hill was not a very pleasant man, apparently, right, from what I've read.
Well, Ray Liotta doesn't end up being a very pleasant character, but...
No, but he's actually charming and shit. This guy isn't the same. He's a bit more brutal than you would... You know, it's not like he was led into it. He was always kind of an a-hole. From what I've read.
Right.
From what I've read. By the way, there was a GQ article written about 5 years ago where they got all the cast together, and it's just like an interview where they're all discussing the movie. It is very interesting if you can look it up.
Yeah.
It talks about how they got the scenes that you know and how they came up with them. Very cool.
Great. I mean, Scorsese firing and all cylinders. This for me is peak Scorsese. Not for everyone. I realize some of his early work people prefer.
No, it is definitely for me.
For me, there is no better film from his filmography. So, yeah, Goodfellas, 100% agree. So, straight back to you for 1991. And surely, again, we're on the same page.
No, I don't think so. We are on this one.
Uh-oh.
I don't think we are. Because I actually didn't want to put this one down because we had just talked about this in an actual full review. But it's Point Break. 91 is Point Break for me. This is a film that captures the zeitgeist of the 90s, yet is somehow still timeless, okay? That's what that goes like. It's my fave. Wait, I'm now wondering what yours was. Oh, you'll tell me in a minute.
You can't handle the truth!
Oh, really?
No, that's not my favorite. That's
earlier
than that. But just, wow. I just think this is a huge... I understand you love Point Break. You made that very apparent in our recent review. Mm. But to be better than the film that I have as my 91, which I think is objectively one of the greatest films ever made.
It may well be because we're doing favorites, remember?
Yeah, I know, And that's why we can't, there's probably no point to voting this week's list either because they're favorites. We're not trying to
objectively say... No, they're favorites. It's like you didn't get it wrong because it's that what it is.
Yeah, we acknowledge that some of our choices are ridiculous and we shouldn't be punished for those, I don't think.
That's right. May I just say that this film is one of the original To Me bromances, okay? So Laurie Petty is supposed to be Keanu Reeves' love interest, but he's actually just fucking in love with Patrick Swayze.
We didn't talk about that in the review, but you're absolutely right.
That's why he couldn't shoot him.
Swayze's Bodie's equally in love with Utah because several times he stops him being killed and could have killed him and doesn't.
Dude, he's like, don't you know who this is? This is Johnny Utah. He recognizes him from his college ball days. It's love at first sight, and that's what bromances are like, people. The meet cute for a bromance happens fast, man. It ain't like some woman and a man where you gotta go back and forth and shit. I'm telling you, man. Meet cutes are big when it's dudes. I'm saying. So, you know, look, if you want to hear more, listen to our review. That's probably a couple episodes back. But this is great. So what is yours, Paul, though? Well, what did you put in?
I don't want to get too far away from this because it's very important that we also acknowledge for people who don't listen to their reviews and just do the countdowns that, this is equally related to Point Break.
Listen, you snot-nosed little shit. I was taking shrapnel and caisson while you were crapping in your hands and rubbing it on your face.
You know, I can sense like an animal when Paul's about to drop a sound.
Well, it's only because you can see me on the connection. That
No. When you're stretching it out, I'm like, here it comes. Here it comes.
Which, for the record, while we're on the topic, next week, if things continue the way they are and if the government continues to roll back, Wayne and I will be able to enter the same recording space again for the first time.
That's right. In case you didn't notice, we're all doing this remotely. Yeah. Hopefully you didn't notice.
So,
but yeah.
Hooray.
That will be fun.
And fingers crossed that the improvement here remains
on course. They've now allowed 10 people to hang out at once in a space. Is that right?
From tomorrow. That is correct. From tomorrow. Yeah. So as long as you maintain social distancing 1.5 meters, which we can do in the recording studio, hooray. That'll be great to correct, stuff.
Jerk circles in the park once again. Fantastic.
All right. That's not 1.5 meters, unless you are very well endowed.
Oh, are you supposed to jerk each other up? I thought everyone just... Anyway, sorry, it's all good.
All right, well, my top film, best film, favorite film of 1991 is without a doubt one of the all-time greatest. And I will
probably
just
is.
Play a sound grab from that film to illustrate it for you.
Oh, of course. Yes, it's Terminator 2. Yeah. Of course.
How is this not your favorite film?
Solid choice. I didn't have as good a time as I did in the other one, man.
God.
The Break was a part of life, son. The Break was so cool. I mean, you don't see Terminator 2 referenced in motherfucking...
Hot Fuzz.
Hot Fuzz.
That's because it's beyond reproach. Like, whereas there's plenty wrong with Point Break.
Oh,
go back and check
out. No, there's plenty wrong with it. It's pure
all truth. The things that I think are wrong with Point Break.
I think Point Break is the only time like you ever liked bad acting by Keanu. Oh, that makes the film. But anyway, T2, sure, man, sure. No one's going to argue with this one.
Terminator 2 is an astounding film, which stands the test of time, I think, equally as well, if not even better than Point Break, because the special effects are almost without peer, 30 almost years later.
Yeah, look, it's an expensive, big-budget James Cam thing. It's a masterpiece, no doubt. So is Point Break in its own way.
I'm not knocking. I enjoyed Point Break too, and I get where you're coming from there. All right, now here is the moment of truth then. 1992. You prefer, this might be the moment where the podcast ends.
Okay.
Before you reveal it, Wayne,
yeah.
Let's just pause to consider that statement. What is, Wayne, your favorite film from 1992?
It's the same film that your penis chose that year. It's basic instinct.
Vindication!
My penis has been choosing that film for 28 years, Wayne.
And your penis is seldom wrong. This film here, folks.
This is a great year film. This is a great
year. It was a great year film, man. You know what my runner-up was? It was Sneakers.
Oh, no.
Like, it was like, I love it. I just saw that again recently. I crapped my pants with how good it was. But let's not say
that. Okay, I only watched Sneakers once. But for me.
I know what your runner-up was. I know what your runner-up this year was.
Reservoir Dogs.
Oh, I was going to say Last of the Mohicans.
Last Mohicans,
sure.
Number three. That's how good this year is. The three films potentially in my very high, definitely in my top 100, all from this year.
You know what happened? We graduated from high school this year, and we were still like little ass teenage, like the movies, look at that shit, Hollywood motherfuckers. That's what we were, okay? That's how this played out.
But again, so I think if they stand the test of
time.
It
still was great. Exactly, exactly.
Then they're more than just, we were at the age range where we thought everything was good. How about Wayne's World? Great film.
Oh, yes,
doesn't stand up as well as these other three do. Even Unforgiven, which...
Unforgiven is the one I would have said, yeah.
White Man Can't Jump. This is
easily... White Man Can't Jump, that could have made a favorites list. Like, could have made, you know, like, it's like, this is my the fondness list. If Basic Instinct hadn't given us a sexual awakening.
Basic Instinct just completely shadow over everything else. Brain Dead for me was the other one that came very...
Fuck off, man. Very fuck close. Right
Dead
off.
Alive for you folks in you the state.
Yeah.
Brain Dead.
Look, it was
incredible.
Interesting, but it ain't no damn movie of the year. All right. But,
very
you know,
close,
as I am.
Bitch, please.
Look, as I am wont to do when we sometimes talk about movies that we always talk about, I just want to give you a little few fun facts about
it. Fire away.
Check it out. Leg crossing scene, not in the script. Was created by Paul Verhoeven when he was on the set and he saw a burger. Joe Esther has. Regrets glamorizing smoking in the movie because he all got cancer and shit later on.
Oh, right. Okay.
Really bad. Yep. Catherine and Nick based on real people that Joe knew because he used to be a police reporter. And the ice pick scene gave Sharon Stone nightmares.
Okay.
She actually had a friend telling her jokes off camera while she was doing it.
I have read that too. How about that? Yeah. A lot of that stuff's in Joe Esterhaz's book.
Yeah.
Hollywood
Animal.
Animal, yes.
Yeah.
Which you led to me to read. So,
I did.
Great choice. If you want to hear how much we love this movie, go over and check out the Movie Reviews and 20 Qs podcast and a back episode there where myself and Wayne guested with Sam and Stacey, the hosts of the show there, and spoke about Basic Instinct. And you'll hear a lot of angst, a lot of pain.
Oh, a lot of angst. It's huge.
Shared between Sam, Wayne, and I as we try to understand, to comprehend Stacey's disdain for this film.
But it's since my research has showed me that a lot of people like to shit on this movie, but not me.
Yeah,
and not you.
I don't get it.
That's right.
All right, cool. 1993.
Yeah, 93. Okay, man.
This one's one of the hardest years. I would say this is the year I struggle most with.
Me too, because there was some pure class, and I've gone with my absolute favorite, the one that I like to watch more over and over.
Yeah,
and
that tends to be what favorite films are, right? The ones you return to watch again and again.
That's right, because I will tell you, this isn't the finest film released this year, but it's just my favorite that year. Judgment Night.
That's awesome.
People.
Spoilers for the bonus episode countdown I spoke about with Julio earlier. In my top 100 films from 100 to 91.
Oh, good. I agree completely. But people, just so you understand why this movie turns up here for me. Judgment Night stars Emilio Estevez, Stephen Dorff, Jeremy Piven, Dennis Leary, and Cuba Gooding Jr., and it's all about these dudes going out for a night out using a borrowed RV to drive to a boxing match. They get stuck in gridlock traffic, so they take a shortcut that gets them lost in a real dangerous neighborhood, witness a murder by gang leader Dennis Leary, and now they're on the run because they're being hunted all night by the gang of killers. That's the movie. Fine, all right? What happens now to elevate this, in our estimation, or in mine at least? First of all, we weren't as old as the characters on this, you know, show when we saw it, but we were very, like, we went out a lot when we were in our 20s, like everyone did, right? So
well,
a lot
we
of shit happened.
20, we were 18.
We were 18, that's right. So it was probably almost aspirational to go out to a boxing game with your bros, right? And I always like the one crazy night type of film. I've usually liked those things.
Yep, I'm with you.
Yeah, there's even a movie called Booty Call, which I quite enjoy.
Can't imagine
about
why.
One crazy night. It's got Jamie Foxx in it. It's not what you think, but it's great. It's great. It's great. So, you know, that's pertinent for us at the time. But this is an urban hellscape type film. And we've talked about this before. I want, like, the soundtrack is cooler than shit. Okay. Because it's where they mix two different bands and, like, genres.
Judgment
and it's actually.
No!
There it is. There it is. And you. Surprised you didn't have that song just laying around.
Damn it.
Hopkins directs the shit out of this movie. It's real, a lot of slow-mo in this and that, but it's freaking cool. So I think, I don't know, how, this didn't do so well because what happened was when it was opening weekend in the Bronx, some guys stood up at the theater and started shooting.
What?
In the theater? Wow. Yeah, that's what happened in the Bronx. The film came up as one of the things to blame for that type of behavior, so it did not do well. It took in $21 million on a $12 million budget. Not terrible, but not enough. Yeah,
probably, maybe, right? Maybe just, I wouldn't imagine it had a big advertising budget, so maybe it broke even. But yeah, there you go. It's one that I ordered. I think I mentioned this on the show previously. I had to order it from Canada to get a DVD copy of it. And I've never seen it on
I remember
Blu-ray
that.
Or certainly not 4K. So yeah, there we go. Okay, well that's nice. I can't fault you for that. It's a great film. I love it obviously a lot.
What's
but
yours
it didn't.
Now? What's yours?
It wasn't the same for me as my number one. My favorite film of 1993 is without a doubt Remains of the Day.
Fuck off! I knew you were full of shit.
No, honestly, there were a few here that could have hit the bill. I want to mention them. Tombstone was very, very close as well.
That's what I thought you were going to do.
Tombstone very close. So the one In the Line of Fire with Clint Eastwood, Rene Russo, John Malkovich, also great film.
I adore that film, but I know it's fluff, but I adore it.
True Romance also right up there. So there's a lot of these films which are in the same ilk for me.
The fact that you haven't mentioned one means I know what yours is.
I wonder if you do know what it is. It's not Jurassic Park for everyone playing at home. If you think it's Jurassic Park, you have not listened to the back episodes of the show. That is the one that most people would pick as the one that stands out, the most noteworthy film which has echoed through the ages since with all the multitude of sequels. My number one is Carlito's.
There it is.
Way. Yeah.
Carlito's Way, people. Fantastic. Yeah, that was on my... every one of these years, I've got my selection and I've got my runners-up. And Carlito's Way is in there, as well as Tombstone, as well as A Perfect World, which is a Kevin Bacon really great movie.
Surprises me. Yeah, Perfect World.
It's an odd one. I almost put that in there just so it's amusing, but no, I went true.
I have a soft spot for Cliffhanger as well. I think that's pretty cool.
Cliffhanger's great. Yeah. Cliffhanger's great.
It's dumb. Carlito's dumb as. I'm not defending the film, but it's a great dumb action film. So... yeah, for me, Carlito's Way is just a great story about a guy who's trying to go straight and with not quite peak Al Pacino, but still when he was really, really good.
Oh, man. This is better than his Serpico stuff. This is better.
I think cinephiles
would argue
with us.
It's not classic Al Pacino,
but this is the one that matters for me.
And forget about it.
Sean Penn killing it. Sean Penn at this point in time was going to retire from acting at that early point.
At this age.
And the chance to act with Al Pacino drew him back out. And then the kick-ass direction from Brian De Palma back before he departed.
Yes. Dude, the Sean Penn in this role, as the, I guess, Jewish lawyer or whatever guy with the frizzy hair and stuff, so off who he was, but he killed
he
it.
He shaved the front of his head to give him that haircut.
Did he?
Yeah, which is pretty full-on sort of...
For a dude and an actor, forget about it. You know, he's transforming himself.
I love Carlito's Way. If you want a deep dive on it, Epic Film Guy Nick and I talk about it on our Patreon film series, which is available to all patrons if you join the show. So there you go.
Probably one of the most exciting one-shots as well in this film.
Amazing. With an amazing score. In fact, that's the score I'm going to go out with today now that I have noted that.
Carlito's Way?
Okay.
Cool. All right.
Nana and Nana 4. I reckon we've got the same one here.
Got to be, right?
Surely.
Is it Leon the Professional?
We don't have the same one here.
Oh!
So continue with your discussion.
Okay, I know what you've
done. Yeah, it was very, very
close. And I almost went that way.
1994, a lot of people talk about it as the best year of film ever made.
Really? I mean, I don't doubt it. Look at this stuff here, okay? But like,
rattle them off for us.
I'm not going to change. I'm not going to do the one that you obviously have. So I'll say that my contenders, other than the one I think you chose, is Interview with the Vampire. I loved that movie. Very, very cool. That's all I have here. The other one is the one that I think is yours.
Well, how about Pulp Fiction? How about...
Yeah, good call.
How about Shawshank Redemption? And if you didn't hear that quick there, sorry. I was pouring myself a drink. I mean, there's even if we're going to go a little bit more obscure, The Crow. No one's going to call it the favorite film of 1994, but it's a notable film. The Mask is a notable film. Ace Ventura is a notable film. Clerks, Kevin Smith's first film. This film has just wall-to-wall memorable films. Speed, Natural Born Killers, Lion King. Fucking I hate it, but Forrest Gump. So you can,
oh, man.
It's a hell of a year for
actually,
cinema.
That's a really good point. Yeah, okay, nice one. But as for Leon the Professional, everyone, if you haven't seen it, it's about a professional hitman, Leon, who is Hangdog Cool, played by Gene Reno, and he encounters Matilda, played by Natalie Portman, in her first role, and he basically has to take her under a wing after her family gets killed, ends up protecting her, teaches her how to become a hitman at her insistence. But it's basically got a Gary Oldman in it as well,
hit
playing
person,
insanely
please,
over
mate.
The top. Hit person, excuse me. look, everything about the movie is cool because it feels like an eccentric French drama masquerading as a violent action movie or vice versa. It's two things,
but it's cool. Wonderful star, like absolute filmmaking turn from Gary Oldman as the villain.
Easily. Like, it's a big, hard-punching, fast-moving American movie, but it looks like European cinema. That's my big fan of this one. One of my favorite movies of all time, I would say. This one.
It's a great film. It's very, very close to my number one. But my favorite film of this year is another Arnold film. It's the last great gasp from Arnold as the action icon that he was. It's True Lies, as directed again by James Cameron.
See, I almost knew so much that you would have this. That's why I didn't choose mine, so we'd have something to talk about.
True Lies.
But I understand.
I remember seeing the cinema, watching the opening scene. I remember the feeling I had. It was like, this is James Bond, but violent. This is James Bond, that opening scene, but with Arnold Schwarzenegger in it. And then he does the tango scene with, what's her name, Tia Carrere.
Tia Carrere.
Oh, my God. That scene gave me chills. And then we get Bill Paxton kicking ass.
Sorry, being a complete dick, but working it so well.
Yeah, I mean, he's a dick, but just kicking ass in that role.
He's nailing the role.
Jamie Lee Curtis is the perfectly cast kind of, you know, housewife who's bored back in those days, 26 years ago, and
happens to be Cha-Cha's.
Wants to make her life better for herself and goes about, therefore, maybe not the right way. I'm not supporting that part, but how things come together is so satisfying. And James Cameron, I would say, yes, we got Titanic afterwards, and then we get Avatar however many years after that. But for me, this is James Cameron peak period. Terminator 2 and True Lies, I love the shit out of them. Action
not
extraordinaire
aliens?
Films. Sorry?
Oh, Aliens. Oh, yeah, not Aliens. Aliens of Ridley Scott. Sorry, yes.
No, Aliens was James Cameron.
Alien.
Yeah,
so it was, yeah. Sorry, Ridley
Scott. If you want to take it back that far, which I would, Abyss is in the middle as well. So those four films are just stellar. Stellar films. And then he follows up with Titanic and Avatar. Guy, he can make
Titanic's
what he wants.
Right.
I wish he was
great
paying
too.
Attention to more than three Avatar sequels, but there you go. So
that's what he's up to now.
That's my favorite film with 94.
Very nice. True Lies. God, we talk about it a lot, and we should.
Well, that's always going to be the case. This is the heyday of our cinema, as you pointed out.
Yeah, no, this is actually really
exciting.
These
are the films that come up again and again on the podcast. And if we did 70s, it would be a little bit different. When we do 2000, probably different again. So, yeah.
Totally. This is pure nostalgia, and hell, I feel like going out to buy some jazz aftershave. So, okay, that's what happened. 1995, people. Again, a fantastic freaking year. But I'm going to go with Desperado.
Ooh.
Yeah.
How close are we, sir? Not quite there.
Not quite there. Okay, quite there. Fine. All right. Well,
but so I've, close. It, I totally understand it, and I have no qualms.
People, if you haven't seen this movie, you have to. In short, it is about Antonio Banderas playing the character of El Mariachi, and he's a one-man army of sorts, a guitarist whose playing ability is lost after he got shot in the hand in the previous film, and the woman he loves is shot dead. So this is a sequel with that guy, a big-name actor. Now, he's just basically all of the action scenes, or a lot of the action scenes, are almost like part shooting and part interpretive dance. Okay? Because he looks so good moving that he's doing pretty much physics defying type shooting that happens in there. He seems almost impervious to bullets, but again, it's one of those, I'm not saying it's the best film ever made, but it's one of the most exciting and fun films ever made. Not very much angst with the lead character. Doesn't need to have it. No moralizing? Doesn't need that shit either. We're here to come. So that's why it's just giving you pure action, pure satisfaction, fantasy.
Whoa, hold on.
We're here to come, ladies and gentlemen.
That's right, Paul. That's what every audience is thinking in the back of their head, but they don't always say it like I do.
What? No.
It's a good choice, though. I don't begrudge you it at all. I am trifle surprised that you didn't take this opportunity to jump on the Kevin Costner bandwagon yet again with Waterworld.
You know, there's nothing that wrong with Waterworld, okay? It's just very
There
long.
We go. It's another good year, though. You are absolutely right. Like, from the Crimson Tides to the Bravehearts of the world to the Toy Stories of the world. And I bet you there's a lot of our listeners out there who thought I would Toy Story this choice up. But you're incorrect.
I have an idea what you might be going with.
It's also where David Fincher hits his stride with 7.
Oh, shit.
All right? Which is one
7.
That's not my choice, but I thought it was yours. Oh. My choice.
No.
And I know it's not fashionable to like this film anymore because of the director and the shit he's got himself in and the star and shit he's got himself in is the usual suspects.
Yes, that's what I thought. It was either going to be that or Get Shorty.
Get Shorty. Another great, great film as well.
Pure class. Now, let's just jettison the whole director shit and talk about this movie.
Yeah, okay? Acknowledging that and putting it to one side, this film blew my mind when I saw it. And I know I've heard people come to this podcast, this movie on their podcast well after the fact, and they'd heard about it in the zeitgeist and they knew what Kaiser Soze was. And
if you know that, the film's over.
Of course, if it's not going to be as effective for you. But at the time, if you went into this film as a no-name thriller, bunch of dudes get arrested for a crime and a crime spree goes from there, that was good enough to get me into the cinema when I was this age, and it would be good enough to get me to watch the film now if it had some semi-notable actors in like Gabriel Byrne and Kevin Pollak and Kevin Spacey and Stephen Baldwin back then.
Look, Steve Baldwin, we didn't know much. Benicio, I had never heard of before. Oh, okay. Right?
I knew them all a little. Like,
I hated his character. You know this, right?
Yeah, we know how much you hate Ben stuff.
Fuck that guy, right? But other than that, of course this is the shit. Like, for a movie to fool you this well, or us this well, at the time, while not, like, us being... It's just basically unreliable narrator, sort of, but not, but this. But, you know, just lots of levels going on. It was almost a cinematic awakening for me, at least, when you see that a movie can do this.
Well,
like a Hollywood movie could do this.
This film plus Reservoir Dogs, which, you know, got missed out. It's my best film. Pretty much combined to cause us to make films of our own. So that's how impactful they were.
Absolutely.
And I couldn't look past it.
Misguided. Totally. Oh, by the way, GoldenEye. Great.
GoldenEye as well. That's right. All right. So that's 1995. On to 1996 for you, Wayne.
Sweet. Everyone, I recently did a guest spot on Two Peas in a Podcast show with Gerald. Okay. And I know, Paul knows what I'm saying here. Dropping soon. Go check it out. And we talked about our top five Tom Cruise films. And guess what? This one I'm picking was not on my top five.
What?
Yeah, it wasn't.
What? All right? What? No.
It's on my top 10, but it's not on my top 5. This is blowing my mind. Maguire.
This is blowing my mind. Wayne has frequently cited this film as one of his favorite films of all time.
Absolutely. It's probably like...
But it's not his top 5 Tom Cruise films. Well, I have egg on my face.
No, top 10. Here's what happened, okay? Well, okay, so it's 1996, and it reminds me of how I used to think as a man in 1996, and I don't necessarily enjoy that. This is a very capitalism-focused type movie. It's like that kind of shit. But in terms of, it's still one of my favorites, and it's quite possibly Tom Cruise's most human film to date, I would say. It structurally does not follow a standard romantic comedy format, but it is a romantic comedy, and I don't know, it came at a time where Cruise started working with like auteurs, people who wrote their own shit and stuff like that. I adored it. I saw it with my mom, oddly, but it meant a lot to my life. So yeah, Jerry Maguire, man, it's still great. It just because I didn't like myself at the time doesn't mean it's not great.
Cannot wait to hear the Two Peas on a Podcast episode, then to hear films beat it for you for Tom Cruise films.
Oh yeah, I reference you often in that episode.
I'm sure you do.
By the way, this is the year that... Oh, no. Actually, tell me what yours is.
Yeah, you could legitimately be uncertain which would be my favorite film
easily
from this year. But it was, in the end, a very, very tough decision. And it came down to two films. The one which didn't win was The Frighteners.
Oh, really?
So
of course I love that
my
one.
My favorite film from 1996 is From Dusk Till Dawn.
Oh, shit. I thought you were going to do Swingers.
No. Swingers Dusk there. Till Mission Dawn. Impossible's there. Yeah. Another great film.
Yeah, it's tough. It's tough, this list. From Dusk Till Dawn.
Bounds, another great movie. The Rock is fantastic as well.
The Rock is fantastic, man.
But I am From Dusk Till Dawn. This is the movie I saw this film 3 times at the cinema.
I remember Paul's love for this film.
I love this film. It's like everything. It's Quentin Tarantino writing dialogue in a Quentin Tarantino way. And it starts out as this sort of crime thriller road movie and metamorphosizes halfway through.
Morphs.
Yeah, that one. Transforms into this horror survival film halfway through, which has got its tongue firmly in its cheek. And it's funny and it's exciting and it's a star maker for George Clooney if ER wasn't already. And it's got a great cast, and other than Quentin
Tarantino. He was a badass, all right. Like, He had the tattoos like go yep. that go from under his shirt up to his neck, and only badasses can do that and pull it off.
Everybody be cool.
As we all know.
You.
As we all know.
Be cool.
Be cool.
One of the greatest.
He's got a cool voice, man. And that's what was cool about that soundtrack.
And he kills the die. I mean, Harvey Keitel even as the dad. Man, in what seems like this very secondary role, this film's phenomenal. Some great gore gags, some great moments later on. It's over the top. Absolutely it is. And if you don't like that, then you're going to hate this fucking movie. And if you don't like horror, you're going to hate this fucking movie.
That is what some people...
Yeah, if you want a Tarantino film, you're going to hate this fucking movie because you get it for the first half and then suddenly like, what the fuck am I dealing with here?
Yeah, that's what happened with some people. That's why it was somehow... Like, some people don't like it like that. But I remember how you pitched it to me. You said to me, yo, man, we got to see this film. It starts out as a road movie, then it turns into a horror. And I went, what? And he goes, yeah, that's what it does. And that already sounded weird to me. But walking in knowing that, it made it better. So if you walked in going, this is great, oh, what the fuck.
There's a moment in the early on the film like where one of the characters gets shot through the hand and is looking through the hole in his hand
yep.
with a shot through the hole in his hand and then tapes that with duct tape and never mentions it ever again other than to occasionally, oh, ouch.
Yeah.
That's like the kind of film you're dealing with.
Totally. And it works perfectly for what it is. Nice one. Nice one. All right, definitely true to you, man.
Thank you. 1997.
It's Face Off, man.
Yeah.
It's Face Off.
Yeah, was very close for me. I understand why really? It's yours.
Everyone, Face Off, I remember at the time, I don't know if I still think this, but at the time we thought to ourselves, by the way, first of all, Nicolas Cage, John Travolta, they swap faces. One's an FBI agent, one's a bad guy. I'm sure you know about this thing. But more importantly, we thought to ourselves that for a John Woo film in this time, it did not feed what we called the bullshit machine at the time as much as it could have. The only thing that really, apart from if you accept all the technology, the only thing that maybe was a bit of a stretch is that Castro Troy somehow escapes this island prison. I know. It was 1997. And for some reason, they had plastic surgery down so pat that you could swap people's faces and it would be.
Just say anything about their voices.
Oh, the voices. There was a voice modulator box that they put under the perfect. Throat. Yes, you're okay. Right. Hey, I was... whatever, man. It's a movie. I'm happy with it.
I can sound like anyone I want to sound like if I want to.
Absolutely. I mean, I could have done that without any kind of tech, but that's like, I'm just saying it's like...
Wayne, do you Sean Connery?
You're back. There you go. You know what I'm saying? It's like he's here in the room.
If I wasn't looking at Wayne through the video camera, I would think Sean Connery had come out of retirement and was about to tell me how he was going to hit some woman for the hell of it. Which we don't agree with on this show, which is absolutely fucking inappropriate, Sean Connery, and that's why you need to retire, you fucking old warhorse.
I prefer to use an open fish. That's what he fucking said!
Oh my god, shit. I shouldn't laugh. It's fucking abysmal. But anyway, sorry. I'm not sure why I went Sean Connery because I thought you could actually do that, but that's why I went there.
No, but yeah, again, the only thing that we thought was bullshit about this movie is that Castor Troy manages to escape from a prison island rig that is somehow in the middle of the ocean. That's the only thing that, that really didn't work for us.
Suddenly he's on shore. Like, well, that was convenient.
We guess he found a boat, but we never saw any boats. Mm. That's it, though. The rest of it, this movie, batshit insane, completely serious, utterly goofy, and always entertaining. Yeah, play over the rainbow later. While people are getting shot? Fantastic. Why not? So, yeah. Face Off, that's mine. What you want, Paul?
What's your 97? I did war with a number of different films. This is another tough year. The Dential,
hugely
very good,
year.
Doesn't get there. Face Off, very good, doesn't get there. It came down to two. And the one that came second for me is another Nick Cage film, Con Air.
Yeah, man! I thought that's where you were going to go, nope. Con Air, dude.
Nope, I went with, my number one is without a doubt, Paul Verhoeven's Starship Troopers.
Oh, okay, now here is where Paul takes the Wayne role and makes a call that is true to himself, but everyone would like to shit on. Although, I don't know.
It's had a bit of a renaissance, like to crap I think, on this movie. In more recent
it
years.
It has.
People now has don't just see it as this deadly serious, but over-the-top sci-fi action film. They kind of see that it was meant to be a satire, and it was.
Right.
At the same time as being an over-the-top action, gory film. For me... a bunch of no-names where they're sunk all the money into special effects. And the special effects for 1997 are astounding.
No, they're good. I remember you holding the torch for this movie.
So much so that I've been lambasted throughout my life about my love of this film. And I don't
big
care.
Time.
I've seen it several times. I saw it twice, three times at the cinema. The last time, fell asleep because I was too drunk, which is one of my most shameful moments. At a midnight screening. But man, I love this movie. And yes, it still entertains. And a while back I did on Word Salad Radio, we did a recap of this film or a return to this film, and I still enjoyed my time in. It's a bit more problematic as a reviewer these days, but I can't deny the fact.
Is it? Why?
Bits and pieces that don't quite hold up 23 years later. But
politically, you mean?
Yeah, politically. The protective banner that is satire. But nevertheless, love this movie, and I will happily watch it once a year, no problem at all.
It wasn't all no names. You got your Michael Ironside.
Yeah,
you got your
Michael Ironside would be exception, probably.
Denise Richards, big at the time?
No, she wasn't. This is the film that made her big at the time. Well, yeah, I'm pretty sure Wild Things was after this.
And our favorite, Dina Meyer. There you go.
And again, don't think she was big. I don't think any of these people were big.
Well, I don't think she ever got at the time. Big, but, you know. Okay. Yep. Good one. Good one. Could have easily been there. But my 1998, there was
hold
no.
On. Hold Sorry. On. This is going to be very, 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 very problematic, I feel like, this year is. So I need.
Oh, no. This would.
I need. This, I need to on. Get the soundboard ready just in case. Here we go. Fire away, sir. Your 1998 film.
All right. First of all, this is not going to be your film. Whatever I choose here will not be what you chose.
God,
all right.
God, oh my God. Oh my
but there was
God,
no doubt God, in my mind. Oh my God, oh my God. 1998's best film in my eyes was Out of Sight. Ow! Yeah! Steven Soderbergh! I always call this the sexiest film ever made. I still think it is, everyone. George Clooney is an ex-con who robs banks and he's chased down by a U.S. Marshal, including Karen Sisko, played by J-Lo. This is George at his most charming. Gentleman thief character. He's like a Cagney or a Bogart or a Steve McQueen. This guy's robbing a bank, but you want him to get away with it. J-Lo. If you ever had any doubt that she's made of 100% pure hotness, this film will dispel that. It is stylish, engaging, made from an Elmore Leonard novel, which I read because I like this film so much. Uh-huh. And then the Karen Sisko character even turns up in the TV show Justified because it's the same writer, that kind of thing, played by Carla Gugino. Don Cheadle's in this, bad guy. I'm telling you guys, this is the date night film, as long as you're dating a strongish kind of woman. That's what I'm saying. That's what you need to do. This is how you should work that night. Word. What do you say, Paul?
Fully acknowledging this is personal best films, and we're not trying to say that they're the top
Absolutely.
Films of the year.
Absolutely.
You're a cunt. You're a cunt now. You've always been a cunt. And the only thing that's going to change is you're going to become an even
possibly
bigger cunt.
Be on Paul's.
Or if you prefer.
You insignificant little
I don't prefer any of these, you fucking fuck! anyway, eat some dick and tell us what you
clearly the best film of 1998 and my favorite film of 1998. It's as good as Out of Sight it is. I'm not denying it's not a good film.
Yeah,
it's very, very good. It's Saving Private Ryan. So once again,
feels like a seven.
You have shafted this film so badly. It hurts.
You know, here's the thing. Are you telling me, though, that there's no doubt it's the fucking balls, but is it your favorite?
Yes.
So you don't watch that thing over and over when you can just watch J-Lo's ass?
Well, I've got the choice between that
man.
And the Thin
know.
Red Line.
Oh, fuck the Thin Red Line. That's not even on the board, all right? Fuck that shit.
Or, you know, right? American History X. Armageddon, great films. Love them. You know, love
See, Armageddon, I would have bought from you.
Blade.
Yeah, Blade. Well, yeah, absolutely. Oh, shit, it was
Wild
the
Things was this year, by
shit.
The way, so it was after. It was after.
Excuse
such
me, Wild Things? Is that on your list?
No, I'm just looking through the list now.
Are we talking about Kevin Bacon and Denise's titties? Is that what you're talking about? Oh,
you know me. I it's see a pair of thick, weighty breasts, and all logic flies out the window.
In this case, permissible.
It's fine. It's fine.
Same part, Ryan. I don't need to talk about it anymore. I've talked about it enough on the show. The fact that Wayne has
That's
overlooked
true.
It yet again hurts
on purpose
more
on purpose.
Than should be. But let's get on to 1999. And this one, surely, Wayne, surely we're on the same page here.
I think we are. I think we would be. I think we would be. But who the fuck knows, Paul? My 1999 pick is Fight Club.
No, God.
What?
But I totally understand because it was a 1-2 punch for me. This was ironically number two.
Oh, you chose not to talk about Fight Club.
Yeah. All that.
People, the theme of Fight Club is facing your fear, doing painful things that are out of your comfort zone. That's basically what it's about, okay? I mean, it's a bunch of other shit, and it's a bunch of capitalism talk in there, and all this sort of shit. But here's the thing I took from that movie, or one of the things I took from that movie. If you, that day, as a, let's say a dude like me, all right? If you've engaged in a fist fight, which is something everyone is scared of, violence, okay?
Most people.
Nothing else. Yeah, most people, okay? You get in that fight every morning, or let's say most days of your life, then what normal day occurrence could ever scare you the rest of that day? Nothing. That's what, Okay? So if you're just like, if you go to, I'm not saying start fighting everyone. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that as a dude.
To be clear, the Countdown Podcast does not endorse fighting your way through any disagreement. And in fact,
encourages
productive conversation towards a common end.
There you go. Paulie with the disclaimer. But yes, absolutely. So, but I just think that that's one of the visceral things about, I'm sorry, guyhood, because I'm a guy and I don't know how it's like to be a woman. Right? Although if you hear Paul, not so much. That's something that spoke to me at the time. It's just that, like, because I abhor violence, especially when it's being done on me. But I could see how it would make you a little bit bulletproof if you were used to it. Not that I would ever do that. So there you go. Fight Club, people.
The Countdown Podcast, where we take your philosophical considerations of films and take them to their nth conclusion.
I think it's an alternate view on what we would normally talk about with this film. So yeah, I think so. But what was your 1999?
So number two was Fight Club. Number one is also a film which is all about facing your fears, confronting them, and surging forward. Nevertheless, The Matrix.
Yeah, of course it was The Matrix. And I understand why you went there, because we really had never seen anything like it. And in terms of bullet time for cinema,
game changer.
Has anything ever been that like widely adopted across the years?
No, I think that's exactly the point. The Matrix, apart from for me being that jaw-dropping, like some of those sequences of The Matrix, still to this day, I get a chill of excitement watching them.
I'm a fan of the running up the wall while getting shot at thing. That thing's great. I mean, of course, with the slow-mo, and God knows
that whole lobby scene's incredible. On the roof scene's incredible. At the start of the film, if I go back for a moment here, incredible with Trinity being chased by the agents. And then,
oh yeah,
for me, the most iconic moment in that film is when Trinity, hanging off that rope, slams into the camera and the camera cracks.
Yeah.
And the whole wall does that sort of undulation ripple out from the point of impact.
The that's windows,
It's the most iconic moment for me in a film, which is incredibly iconic to represent how different this is. The idea that the world, again, to be philosophical for a moment, the world is not what we have constructed it to be, is such a powerful idea for me. And just has echoed through what I love about not just cinema, but books and the like ever since. To explain the inexplicable in a different way is something that I love in my literature and films.
Then let me ask you this, Paulie. The Cypher Joey Pants character once says to Neo in the film, if we knew this it was going to happen like this, we'd have told Morpheus to shove his red pill up his ass. Now, I'm asking you, Morpheus turns up, right?
Mm-hmm.
And knowing now, if you were in the Matrix or out of the Matrix or in the world where the Matrix was in fact not real or real or whatever you want to call it, and Morpheus offers you the truth, would you take it?
Yes.
You would take it?
Yeah.
So you would happily live in the Ebenezer
or what they know later. Maybe Cypher's right that if once I knew it, I might go back and want to change it. But
okay, I'm asking you now. If you knew it.
Yeah, that's having. It's like, would I.
I'm asking you
would I have dated that woman that I dated who ruined my life? Like, it just makes no sense. Like, you can't have it both ways. You either.
Then it sounds like definitely you would say no. Definitely you would say no, I'd rather live in the Matrix.
You have to make the point then and there. I'm offering you the answer to all of life as it exists now. Or go back to what you're doing before, you'll never hear from us ever again. No, I want the answer, please. Even if the answer is unpalatable.
Really?
Yeah. 100%.
So that means your answer is yes.
After I'd experienced the crappy, weird shit that Neo had already experienced. Like, if I was just standing here about my business right now and Morpheus popped in the room, I would go... I would check myself into a mental health hospital because I'm now officially seeing things and the like. But if I knew from Cypher's perspective, maybe. If I knew what he knew, maybe ignorance is bliss. Maybe.
Ignorance is totally bliss. I would absolutely not want to leave. But, there you go.
But you can't have it both ways. You either know it or you don't. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, and you can only know it after the fact, not before it.
Yeah, you know what would happen to me? I'd say, yes, give me the red pill. I'd say, this is fucked. Can I go back? He'd say, no, I'm going fuck myself. That's what I would do. I'd say, fuck this shit.
All right, there it is. That's our best / favorite films of the 90s. We did have some very strong disagreements and we had the occasional on the same page. But I think because we know each other well enough that we weren't too surprised too often there.
No, I don't believe so.
But the listeners had, and because of course there's no honorable mentions, we've already really been through those. The listeners had some very big alternate takes as well as some agreement. And we'll get into that on the other side of this music cue.
Talk about. Talk about.
kicking off this week's Pop 10 with Land of the List, who had at 90, Home Alone. 91.
Right, okay.
T2, 92, A Few Good Men. So there you are. I think you may have called it right where it was.
A lot of folks like that show, yeah, man.
93, Dazed and Confused. A little part of me surprised you didn't go for that one, Wayne.
I don't think I've seen it, man.
Oh.
For real, I don't think I've seen it, yeah.
Whoa.
I know, it's one of the gaps, man. One of the many gaps.
94, Pulp Fiction. Of course, 95, Dead Man Walking.
Fuck! Look, it was a good film. I just had a bad time with it.
There you go. 96, Fargo. 7, Chasing Amy. 8, Shakespeare in Love. Ooh. Shakespeare in Love over Saving Private Ryan.
I see it happening.
Land of the List, you've hurt me. You've hurt me very, very badly. Number 99, Fight Club. There you are, Wayne.
Boom.
Gidget Von LaRue from the Retro Cinema Podcast had Goodfellas, JFK, Basic Instinct. Yes, Gidget.
What up?
In the Name of the Father, The Shawshank Redemption. That makes sense for 94. 7, The People versus Larry Flint. The Fifth Element, Elizabeth at 98, and Bowfinger for 99.
Whoa! Left field at the end there. Nice one.
Stephen from the Super Retro Throwback on Twitter said, I'm just giving you the tradition of giving you my top three. Pulp Fiction from 94, Tremors from 90, and Terminator 2 from 91.
Nice.
That's a nice one as well. Hendo, his birthday, it is today of Day of Recording.
Happy birthday, y'all.
On the Movie Journey Podcast. Hey, Goodfellas, T2, Reservoir Dogs at 92. Totally understand. Jurassic Park would have to be the most popular at 93. Pulp Fiction, 7. Trainspotting, The Dential in 97. I don't think we even mentioned The Dential. LA Confidential.
Yeah, LA Confidential is so, so important.
He has Saving Private Ryan. Yeah, sorry, that's right. Saving Private Ryan, 98, and 99, Fight Club. So that's a pretty good combination list from between the two of us. His co-host, also on the Movie Journey podcast, Dean Jeffrey, had Goodfellas, Terminator 2, Reservoir Dogs. Sounds very similar so far. Groundhog Day, Shawshank, 7, Romeo and Juliet for 96, Wayne.
Great show.
97, The Dential, 98, American History X, and 99, Fight Club. You can tell why those two are in a podcast together.
Let's just note that The Dential is what we used to call LA Confidential. I did. In case you're like, what the fuck is he saying? I know he said it, but like it's easy to miss.
Daniel the Socially Distanced said The Phantom Menace from 1999. Not the best Star Wars, but by any means, but my first time hearing the wonderful score in a theatre. There you go, Wayne.
What?
Someone
who must be a young'un.
Appreciation for a score made them remember one film more than any other film from a decade.
Had to happen eventually.
Over to the Facebook listening community then. And Philip Meany had Goodfellas, The Naked Gun 2.5 from 91. Glengarry Glen Ross.
Great stuff.
True Romance. The Crow. Heat. Paradise Lost. The Child Murders at Robin Hood Hills. That just blew my mind. No idea what that is. The Dential. The Big Lebowski, and A Room for Romeo Brass. So some ones there I've never even heard of.
I don't know that one. Yeah. Okay, nice.
Very nice. Brad Chessel said, Total Recall, T2, Reservoir Dogs, Groundhog Day, Pulp Fiction, Heat, B&B Do America, Beavis and Butthead Do America.
Yeah, that's Paul's jam.
Not really. Good Will Hunting, There's Something About Mary, and The Matrix for 99. Kristen Nacaro, Goodfellas, Silence of the Lambs, Aladdin, Jurassic Park, Shawshank, Clueless, The Birdcage, Titanic / The Lost World, Jurassic Park. You can't have both, Kristen. That's cheating. Patch Adams and 10 Things I Hate About
Great
You.
Great call, Heath Ledger, Boston.
Better Hans. Than The Matrix and Fight Club?
Just to piss you off? Yeah.
All right, last couple then to wrap it up. Sam Hurley from the Movie Reviews and 20Q's podcast. Want to give him a big shout out. Misery, Silence of the Lambs, Basic Instinct.
Kaboom.
Groundhog Day, Pulp Fiction, 7, Fargo, LA Confidential. And for 98, the 7th best war film of all time. And The Matrix for 99. Good on you, Sam. And then Adelaide Spence, Back to the Future Part 3 from 90. Point Break. There you are, Wayne.
Point Break. Yes, sir.
Reservoir Dogs. Adam's Family Values. Quiz Show. Braveheart. Star Trek First Contact. Face Off.
Yeah.
Shakespeare in Love. Again, two people that prefer Shakespeare in Love over Saving Private Ryan. Not to mention.
There was a blow up that year. Yeah.
What did you go that year? I can't even remember now.
I can't remember, but it won the Oscar and everyone was like pissed about it.
And Fight Club for Adelaide Spence. And last one here, Kevin Lawler said, Goodfellas, Silence of the Lambs, Unforgiven, of course. Jurassic Park, Shawshank, Casino from 95, Hamlet from 96, Titanic 97, Shakespeare in Love. Again, this is madness, people, madness. Which is the angriest Joseph? Fucking soundboard thing I can produce.
Joseph finds an attractive, charming man.
And lastly, The Matrix. So thank you to everybody who got back. We had lots of other responses, of course, but with that sort of nature of the list, we couldn't read through them all. We really appreciate your support and response to the show. All right, Wayne, that's episode 265. What are we doing for episode 266 of The Countdown?
Next week, we're going to count down our top 10 movie mysteries. Shit that you don't know how it went, or it's shit that you were wondering about that happened in a movie. Our top 10 moments like that, right?
That's right. And this comes from an idea from Sally Vaughan, top level patron of the show, good friend.
Hey, Sal.
Who said, top 10 didn't pick the murderer movies. So we've expanded it slightly to be not just about murders and not just who we didn't get right in that regard, but mysteries overall through films. So thank you to Sally for the idea. And we hope you'll
nice
join
work.
Us for that for episode 266 of The Countdown. Thank you, Movie and TV Reviews Podcast. And how do people join and let us know all about their choices for the show, or indeed give feedback overall, Wayne?
By Googling The Countdown Podcast to find wherever the hell we are, which is everywhere, or you can send us an email at thecountdownpodcast@gmail.com.
Follow us on Twitter at @thecountdownpc. Hit us up in the Facebook listener community. Link is in the show notes to join us there and join a whole bunch of other people with great conversations week in and week out. Follow us on podbean.com where we host the show, and we have a Patreon where a whole bunch of extra content is available for you if you have yet to sign up there. And that is it for episode 265.
Booyah.
Top 10. No, decade dominators dominating decades.
We'll come up with something. We'll come up with something.
My name is Paul.
My name is Wayne.
And this has been The Soundboard.
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
Bit of a traditional one right there for you.
Traditionally unfunny. Sure.
All right. We will catch you next week. Cheers.
See ya.
All right, Wayne, that's episode 265. What are we doing for episode 266 of The Countdown?
Oh, obviously I don't know. We're making this shit up as we go along, people.
God damn!